First of all, hi. So I'm Michael Denker. I wanted to be here already much earlier, but as you can probably hear by my voice, I got a little visit from a little friend who basically prevented me from getting out of bed the last few days. So now I'll try this, and if I lose my voice or something happens, then there's an early dinner. So anyway, I'll basically pick up where Thomas left, and probably I'll even repeat a few things that you've just heard, maybe from a slightly different perspective. I'm from the lab of Sonja Grün, but also with Thomas I've been working together now for quite some time, and I think we both share quite a few interests in this general domain of making science more reproducible and working on data, etc. So what I want to talk to you about now is going a bit away from the data and maybe a bit more towards also topics like analysis and how to basically cover different aspects of the life cycle of your data. but in general, when talking about reproducibility, maybe I want to start by just making clear a few terms in the beginning, starting from a general definition of terms, all starting with the letter R, basically, that was put forth by several publications, and also there's a very interesting read on an issue on Rescience on this. It's basically one set of definitions, but you will find other ones. I think this is one of the more better ones. So we can talk about, for instance, something like repeatability. So repeatability means basically it's me who does something, and then at a later point, I do exactly the same again. So for instance, this could be me giving this talk a few months ago, and now I'm trying to repeat it. Now, obviously, it's not going to work. And it's basically a technical thing, because obviously my voice is raspy today, and so it's not really going to be the same talk. Yes, yeah. Actually, yes, but there was no photo. but in essence, basically I know what I did, so in principle I should be able to reproduce it, and I have the same tools available. So this is really often a quite technical type of problem, getting the laptop connected, having a voice, etc., etc. You could also think of Sonja Grün giving the talk, and this is something we could call replicability. So it's basically a different team, but the same setup. So basically, I would give these slides to someone else, and Sonja would give this talk. Now the problem is a bit different. Not only does the technical side have to match, but also it's a question of whether the slides and the words I use on these slides actually convey what I want to say. Does Sonja perceive exactly the same thing? Does she know what she has to say? Are the speaker notes exactly correct? Is everything written down how it needs to be formulated, etc.? So that's a slightly different level of the problem. And then finally, you can also ask for something like reproducibility, a different team, with a different experimental setup. So maybe Sonja decides to convey the same message in a talk, but do a new talk, new slides, maybe call it fair data or something, but try to convey the same message. And here, of course, we have an even more complex problem where we need to also be able to delve into basically what is being conveyed by the research, or the talk in this case, and basically find ways of basically redoing this insight. But this means, of course, also that we correctly described what we did in the reference that we're trying to replicate, and that we have accurate means of basically validating our new replication of the experiment against what we did in the beginning. So in other words, it's a question of how do we compare different experiments in order to validate sort of an experimental finding. So these are more or less the different levels you can go to when you ask about these reproducibility questions. Let me just go into one topic beforehand, which is you can ask, why is this actually such a big topic, and especially in neurosciences? So this is a picture I like to do sometimes of the Rosetta Stone. You probably know it. It's one of these stones with three languages on it, hieroglyphs in Greek and Domitian. And in principle, this was able to help in the translation of these hieroglyphs in particular. In the brain, we often think of something maybe a bit similar. We have basically some sort of brain dynamics. We have stimuli coming into the brain, and we have some output behavior. And we also try to match these. Yeah, this is sort of like very classic type neuroscience, I think. And I think from the beginning on, there were always two problems that we faced in this science. Yeah. One is variability, meaning there's not such a really nice correspondence between these three things as maybe on the Rosetta Stone, right? So stimuli vary a lot. It's very hard to reproduce a stimuli or even a behavior. And if you talk about brain dynamics, you all know that it's definitely noisy or variable, whatever you want to call it. So on the other hand, something we observe is complexity. It's just very hard to control for all of these things. Stimuli and behavior, how to measure them accurately, to like really to pin them down exactly, how to really characterize a stimulus. Either you simplify it extremely so you can describe it, or you have some complex stimulus which is not adequately described. So it's very difficult to do. And then in terms of brain dynamics, of course, that's why we're all here. How do we characterize this? How do we basically deal with the complexity in the brain? So I think this has actually led to two things in terms of reproducibility. On the one hand, you could argue that maybe it's undervalued in the past because of the variability. It's just, if you know, I'm going to measure again in another mouse, and it's going to be roughly the same, but a bit different. So what do I care how reproducible it is? Yeah. On the other hand, you can say, well, reproducibility is simply a difficult task because of this complexity. It's just very difficult to describe this extremely complex setups to a minute detail. And also, it's very difficult to describe the types of analysis things that we do on the brain. So I think these are two reasons which have probably impeded in the past this question for reproducibility. But I think the good news is that now with the age of digitization, you can call it, we actually have one method which allows us at least to combat this complexity task, which is by employing software tools which help us to basically get a hold of this complexity, automate tasks, so that we can like automatically get characterizations of our stimuli, that we don't have to measure them with a ruler like in the 60s or whatever, right? But we have like accurate measurements of this. And the tools that Thomas talked about for gathering metadata and storing them and so on. So we have a lot of help from the side of software. And hopefully, it will then also be realized that in order to understand the variability that we observe in the brain, it's very crucial to be extremely reproducible, because that's the only way how we can actually then discern what is our measurement imprecision versus what's the actual variability in the brain. So in general, what I want to talk about today is this typical flow in an experiment coming from some setup where raw data is being recorded. It's typically then post-processed. From both the post-processing and from the experiment, of course, you get some metadata. This is being compiled, as Thomas had described. In the next step, we then combine the post-processed data and the metadata into a common data model, and then we perform probably some complex parallel and collaborative analysis on this until we reach some interpretation. And in order to do this in a reproducible way, it's probably not a good idea to do it how I guess all neuroscientists, including myself, did it 20 years ago, start up MATLAB, and, or actually not MATLAB at the time, but even other things, and just hack away, but to try to use community tested and standardized software components all along the way where it's somehow possible in order to profit from the knowledge from others, but also in order to be able to actually describe the individual steps in this workflow. So today I want to go through some of these tools, partly in a bit more practical manner, and describe how one can already to do it. They do lots of these things, which is not to say that there's not also a lot still to be done in order to really achieve a nice, totally rigorous, completely documented, completely reproducible workflow. Still a challenge. So just to motivate why, we did ask people a few years ago whether this is really a problem. Also, they see this whole overall complexity in the work that we are doing. And when we asked to which degree that people think that the complexity of the data sets and the analysis basically influences the work, it was quite clear that most people really think that this is an issue, that basically having best practice guiding principles and solutions for workflows is something that would be really appreciated. And when we asked what would be the things that are in need, the top answers were basically that we need common guidelines to describe the entire workflow process, we need public software toolboxes, and standardized data formats. So the community is aware, and this is already old data, I'm sure the numbers would be higher today, which is a good sign, but just be aware that this is a luxury situation, because it has not always been like this. So this is a process that has been going on for quite some time, and as Thomas has said in his lecture earlier, if you had come with, I think you call it file names according to some specific patterns like 10 years ago or so, people were not so happy about such things. So, in general, I'd like to talk about data models first, and I'd like to talk about the NEO data model. Thomas already introduced it very briefly in his talk. I'd like to go a bit more into depth now, also because you will be exposed to this in the exercises later in this course. The idea of NEO is really that you have a wide variety of data sources in electrophysiology. Of course, most prominently, these are recording systems, and here just some of the commonly found vendors that you probably all know about. What you also know about these vendors is that they're extremely protective about their methods, and they all define their own data formats, which they find are always the best, and which are always somewhat difficult to read, and it would not be surprising to me if there are not still also many bugs here and there, given the fact that I also fixed a few in loading routines they provide and so on. So it's but it's not only a question of file formats. The other thing is that, of course, also these recording systems don't just have different labels on the sticker, but they're also different in terms of how they work. You have arrays, you have tetrodes, you have patch clamp, you have whatever. So it's a huge variety of types of data and how these data are structured within these records. On the computational side, of course, there's also simulation going on. And as you are aware, in neuroscience, we are in the happy situation that the community realized early on that you have to distinguish between the description of a neural network model and the simulation engine, which led to the good situation that we now have a variety of network simulation engines available. So you've probably heard of Neuron. There's Moose, there's Brian, there's Nest, there's older ones like Genesis and so on. All of these are basically software that takes some description of a neural network and basically perform a simulation on it. The output is of course different. You have things which produce basically only spike times, such as NEST. You have simulators which can produce more complex outputs, including membrane voltages, etc. You can even have like hyper simulators, which then generate local field potentials from such simulations, etc., etc. However, what's in common to all of these is that the generic or the overall types of data are typically quite comparable to those you get from recording systems. And finally, of course, we may have also other models. So this could be either like textual models. These could be, I don't know, some theoretical models you have in some other language you implemented yourself. But also for these, when we look at the types of data objects that we can get from them, we see a large overlaps. These could be spike rates, spike times, potentials, continuous rates, correlations, maybe these kind of things. So it's a very, very compact set of generic types of data. And this is the main idea of NEO. It's trying to be a internal data representation in Python. So this is something I'd like to emphasize maybe three times now. No, not three times, but it's not a file format. So NEO is not something you write to disk, but it's basically a library in Python that allows you to represent your data in memory while you work with it in a standardized form. Of course, you can save it to disk and load it to disk, but it's not a specification on how to save something to disk. So that's done by other things like NWB, as was mentioned earlier. However, as Thomas also said, it's able to load data from a number of proprietary formats, and basically it delivers semantics by an annotation mechanism. And what all of this means, I'm trying to show in more in-depth now. So again, the generic concept of NEO is, I always see it as a bridge, basically. So you can see NEO as this middle library sitting here. On the bottom, you see different types of data providers, which in general will be file formats. Of course, these could be vendors of EFIS file formats, but it could be also custom file formats such as NIX or HDF5 type file formats, or there's also a way to export to some sort of MATLAB structure. What's not written here, but what could also be used is, of course, input from neural network simulations, for instance. This is also one option. On the other side of the bridge, waiting are different applications. And these basically now wait for NEO to load data from these different types of data providers into something that's generic. And then these applications can work with the data without having to know where the data come from. So since the data structure is now completely identical, independent of the data source, it doesn't really matter anymore, right? And this allows you to write either real applications or your analysis script in such a way that it becomes as reusable and generic as possible. And also, of course, for other people to read your code as easily as possible. They don't have to first understand of how you think that data should be represented in memory. So in terms of the file IOs, this is a pretty recent list of current supported vendors. You see it's quite a lot. And if we add little red dots to it, indicating the different types of file extensions to it, it's even more. It's quite a zoo. And this already tells you that it's in many cases quite convenient. So if you give me some data set in a not completely obscure format, then the beauty of it is you can just give it to me and I can just load it and display it more or less instantaneously. The downside is at the moment still that we get still very little support from hardware vendors to actually support the writing of these IOs. So much of this is community developed. So some IOs work definitely better than others. But of course, if it doesn't work, there's always an incentive also to make it work. also we do hope that with all this research data management becoming more and more of a political issue, that in the future, hopefully also the vendors will feel a greater urge and greater need to actually be represented in a good way in these types of projects. So in terms of what does this, how does this data structure look? So in general, it's divided into several types of objects, which are actually Python objects. The simplest of these is probably the analog signal, it's called. It's basically a time series. Can actually contain several time series. The other one is called the spike train, which is basically a series of time points, signifying a spike train, obviously. There's also something called an irregularly sampled signal, which is, again, a time series, but sampled not at the same sampling interval, but with given timestamps. There are events which signify, for instance, behavioral events in the data. And there's epochs, which, of course, signify a span of time in the data. So in addition to this, there are also objects which group these primary data objects. So one of these is basically the segment. It groups objects in time. So basically it groups all the things which occurred at the same time in the recording. There's something called a unit, which groups spike trains across segments of time. So obviously signifying these spike trains came from the same source. There's something called a channel index, which is able to group individual analog signals into something, into a larger channel group. And finally, there's a block object, which is more or less the container for the complete thing as a whole. So again, there's basically two types of objects in Neo. One represents data, and one relates the data. Idea is here that these objects are completely semantically bland. Yeah, it doesn't say what is a segment. Yeah, it just means grouping by time. So at this stage, there's no meaning attached to all of this yet. Yeah, yes, exactly. Yeah. So if you go into more detail, you see here the five data objects I just talked about, and you see basically the things that they contain in terms of the attributes they contain. What is good to know is that all of these data objects themselves are originally derived from a NumPy array, so intrinsically they can do everything that a NumPy array can. They are then derived from a quantities object, so quantities is a library that allows to attach a physical SI quantity to an array in order, so milliseconds or volts or whatever, in order to basically make this clear. And then basically Neo goes on top and adds all the properties which are in addition required to precisely define this object in terms of its neuroscience context. So for instance, for a spike train, the spike train will have obviously the times of the spike train, so these are just the timestamp IDs, it's a quantity object. But also, in order to fully describe the spike train, you also need to supply a T start and a T stop, so the first time and so the starting time and the stopping time, because if you would not have these two quantity, these two measures, then if you only have the timestamps and you ask something like, was there a spike at T equals 5000? Then you don't know, did I still measure at T5000 or was there really no spike? So it's absolutely necessary to have this information. Of course, also there's some things which are not strictly necessary, but at least very desirable. So for instance, the sampling rate would be something, so you know roughly at which rate these spikes were digitized and the waveforms accordingly. Which are also attached. Similarly, for analog signals, you have the signal itself. You also have the time array, which is missing here, sadly. Oh, it slipped out. The sampling rate and also the T start and things like this. So it's basically there are a number of things which are prescribed, which are necessary to describe these objects, and you always have access to them. But again, there's nothing semantic attached to it yet. It's still very generic. You don't know anything about it. Yeah. There's also some general attributes. There's always a name. There's always a description, which are both strings. There's always a file origin, which means like which file did it come from or which source did it come from. And there's something called annotations. Now, these annotations are now the thing where you can start to add information about what these things actually mean. So for instance, when we're talking about an event, this could be, of course, maybe a drug injection. It could be behavioral cues. It could be a trial start. If we talk about an epoch, it could be a stimulation period. It could be a behavior type. It could be a trial period. And so on. Now, if we go one step further to the grouping objects, and we start with a segment, then basically what you see here is that the segment basically links directly to all of the objects that it contains. So it has basically lists of spike trains, for instance, which contain like all the spike trains which are basically in this temporal segment, so that it's easy for you to traverse the individual objects that belong to a specific thing. Again, the name and the annotations are the things where you can actually then give meaning to what the segment is. Again, this could be a trial, obviously. Could be something like, I don't know, pre and post treatment. It could be something like before the artifact and after the artifact. Or it could be something like, I don't know, completely arbitrary. Yeah. So the same thing we have for the channel index and for the unit. Basically, the channel index links to the units and to the analog signals and irregular sampled analog signals. The unit itself then links to the spike train. So this has been found out to be one structure that is very well able to capture, I forgot the block, sorry, a structure that's very well able to capture most of the recordings that you will come across and is able to deliver a segmentation that's both meaningful for a user to basically segment data, and on the other hand is not too convoluted by including things which actually have a slightly semantic feel to it. Yeah. So for instance, there is nothing like a trial in here, because a trial can always be either represented by an epoch or by directly cutting the data beforehand into segments. Yeah. And this, I think, is one of the biggest challenges. How do you do these things in a generic way, so that it's applicable to everybody, but still easy to use? So here's an example of how to actually use this in practice. So here we have an object A in Python, which is an analog signal. If I just print it, it will directly tell you what it is. It's an analog signal with three channels of length 3000. The units are in millivolts, etc. You will see it's a description. It's a raw signal of a three-contact electrode. And as you see here, annotations is essentially realized as a dictionary. So basically, you can add arbitrary key-value pairs as annotations to this object in order to further specify what it means. If you ask for the sampling rate attribute of this analog signal, then here what you see is it directly gives you one of these quantity objects. Here it's basically something that looks a bit ugly because it's not simplified in this output here. Basically, it means it's 1/30,000th of a second, which is basically 30 kilohertz, which is of course a very ugly unit. And one of the really nice things about having this option of of using quantities to specify things like the sampling frequency here is that, as you see, it's not divided out. It's still a string expression here, so that you actually don't lose any accuracy by now actually dividing 1 over 30,000, which you know will become some very horrible millisecond value and which will cause you pain here and there. But it actually allows you to code the real values here and still calculate with it. So for instance, what I can do is I can call a function called time slice on my analog signal and ask it to cut from 0.5 seconds to 1 second. This PQ here is the quantities library and S is the seconds from the quantities. So I can directly tell it in what, basically in what units I want to have the signal cut, and you will see that despite this ugly sampling frequency here or sampling rate up here, it's able to cut to the correct time indices in a very user readable manner, but also of course in a very defined manner. And of course, you can then also inspect things like, for instance, which segment does this analog signal belong to? So you can, for instance, just ask a.segment and it will tell you exactly in which segments basically this this analog signal is grouped into. Should be multiple. I think this was at the time, this is a bit older slide. I think it was fixed in the meantime that this oh, it is. So this is basically the unit. Yeah. So this is the unit of the sampling rate, and it's not printed here. That's the problem. Yeah. So the beauty is that the unit can be specified as a string. So in this expression here, this is still a string expression that you can directly insert. And only when you're required to actually do a calculation that requires to evaluate this expression, or by you typing simplifier or whatever it's called, then it will basically do this. Thing, yes. And also, what's important to know is that although this is sort of the full Neo tree, you're not required to build everything up, right? You can just work by just having analog signals. You can just work by just having segments and so on. You can have a block, a segment, and events without having any channel indexes and so on. So the idea is to provide you with building blocks which you can put together to create a structure that represents what you want to represent. Of course, when you use the Neo IOs, then of course things are a bit different in the first loading step, because of course the IO needs to make some first decision on how to do it. And here the idea is more or less as you would expect, the file is represented by the block. And then of course it depends on the vendor, but typically the IOs will create a segment for each contiguous piece of recording, and obviously a spike train per spike train if something like this is in, and an analog signal for each recording channel and so on. But then in the further process, you may want to manipulate this, for instance, by cutting trials and stuff like this. So if there's like a very convenient structure for you to work in, then this would be a way to basically restructure your data by cutting, by shifting, realigning, whatever. And then you could, for instance, save this new Neo structure to disk and then use this to collaborate with others and so on. So, yeah. So the question is now that we heard from Thomas basically about metadata, and now we heard a bit more about the data format, and as you've seen, well, we have lots of information now, maybe in an AutoML file. We have a way to load our raw data. How do we merge this now? Yeah. How do we add these semantics? And for this, I'd just like to remind you of this picture. Again, it's a sketch from an experiment where you see the individual machinery that's needed to keep this monkey happy, and the different types of files producing data here and there. again, it's just two files which have the actual data. The rest is all what we would consider metadata, which needs to be recorded. So it's quite a mess. On the other hand, there's also something to consider, which is sort of the temporal evolution of such an experiment. Yeah. So typically, you start off designing some experiment. So assuming a monkey experiment, you start basically a year before you actually take the first data. So you have like a year of collecting metadata beforehand. Then at some point, you have maybe the surgery and something about the recording device. And then you start recording for a year, session by session. At some point, you find a poor guy to do the spike sorting who will start at some point. And then at some point, maybe you get to quality check. So this is, of course, not a sequential progression. The best thing is, of course, that latest here, these things would go basically in parallel as much as possible to avoid any data loss or bad data or whatever. But essentially, you see that there is also a point of collecting metadata in time. And so the question is, how do you structure then the data into such an AutoML structure? How do you form these hierarchical meta representations? And here, it turns out that essentially, we tend to group the metadata according to our own categories of how we tend to think of our experiment, both in terms of the equipment that we use and also in terms of the temporal evolution that we use. So for instance, we may have one category of metadata we consider as post-processing. So that's something that comes at the end. Or we have one category of metadata that belongs to the monkey or the animal or the subject. Or we have one category of metadata that belongs somehow to the recording system and this kind of thing. So we tend to think of these broad categories and tend to structure our metadata according to these principles. What then typically happens is that we need some way of basically collecting the metadata from these individual files. I don't want to go into the detail to it. There's one publication describing this in more detail, but just to mention in general, what's happening is that we create templates, which basically give a rough structure of how we want to represent the metadata. And from the left side here comes in this heterogeneous gush of metadata, and then we have some scripts which basically merge the two and spit out an AutoML with the combined information. And how this looks, I'd just like to quickly show in an example of one published data set, which is now on the GIN infrastructure that I guess you've seen already and that Thomas talked about. And maybe coming back to one question that was raised in the discussion of the last talk, why, for instance, put it on GIN in this case? Why use a repository that is specific to this type of data? I think one of the best answers is that if you use a repository that's specific to a specific type of data, is that often you will profit from certain little gimmicks of this repository. So for instance, in this data repository, if we go to the actual data sets and we click on the AutoML file containing the metadata, then if network speed allows, we actually have here a viewer integrated into the GIN repository that allows to directly view the AutoML file in this repository. So I can directly see the data to a better degree than I could see it had I deposited it on something generic such as Zenodo or so. Yeah. So I have to turn my back now because of this situation. But just in general, this is what a student or former student of ours, Liebert Zehl, came up with after quite some time. Basically a quite complex set of metadata structured according to these generic types of categories that I just talked about. And you see that, for instance, you will have information often quite scattered across these individual categories. So for instance, you will see that in the pre-processing, you will have a section offline spike sorting. Yes. I'll try. Is that better? Sorry about that. So you will see here there's some information about offline spike sorting, which is basically contained here. But also, if I go to the recording equipment and then to the array that was implanted here, and I look at the information per electrode, then again, I will also see information from the offline spike sorting, which is then the specific information about units on this particular electrode. So what this means is that there's now information about the spike sorting, which I obviously want to have included later when working with the data in several locations in this AutoML file. And there's always a big problem in terms of, so how can I structure data on the one hand that it's makes sense for me when I want to view the metadata in the way that Thomas showed, for instance, generating overviews, getting an overview of the data, understanding the data set. And on the other hand, understanding which of these metadata makes sense in the context of which of the actual data objects that I have. Yeah? So for instance, when I look at this spike train, which information do I need? Well, I probably want to know from the artifact rejection whether it was whether I should use the spike train. Maybe I want to know something from the spike sorting. And maybe I'm even interested in, yeah, I don't know what, where this electrode was, where the spike was on. Yeah, so whether this was a electrode in prefrontal cortex or whether it was in, who knows where, yeah, and so on. So in general, this is a problem that there's no real consensus yet on how to map this. And this means this means essentially that we need to do this mapping ourselves at the moment. Yeah. However, the fact that in the AutoML we have key value pairs and that we are able to annotate Neo with key value pairs also makes this much less a complicated task than we may think. So essentially, we could think of, for instance, saying, okay, the units which basically specify the neurons in my recording, what I really want to know is the signal-to-noise value on each of these new units. And these may be saved in the AutoML as metadata information coming from some post-processing script that just calculates SNR values for all the units. Then basically the thing to do would be to simply annotate all of the units in the Neo structure with the corresponding value from the AutoML. So essentially, the workflow that's currently, I think, to my understanding, the best thing to do at least, is really to have something, I would like to call it maybe a derived I/O, which is basically an experiment-specific I/O, which has basically two tasks. First, it loads the metadata using the AutoML library. Then it loads the data using a specific I/O of the Neo library, so for instance, a BlackRock data file. And then the task of this I/O is simply to put selected key value pairs from here onto the Neo object that comes from here. You probably don't want to put everything because it's just much too much. It's like 11,000 key value pairs, and this is just not going to make things easier for you. but you probably just want to select a few which are actually really meaningful for you for your specific analysis task. For instance, signal to noise for a unit. So you can say later on, okay, do this analysis, give me all the units which have a signal to noise larger than 3. And then do the same thing again and ask for all units which have a signal to noise larger than 1 and see if you still get something similar to corroborate your result. So this Neo object is something you can work on. Of course, you can then save it either to Nix or to plain HDF5 or whatever, and then also have basically a fixed copy on disk for further use. If you collaborate with people, then you will always have to decide either you work jointly on this derived IO or whatever you want to call it, so you work jointly on this code, or you basically decide on some new saved version of the data and share this. Both have advantages and disadvantages. This is a bigger file size, but it can lead to less problems. This requires more discipline among the collaborators to update their code on all sides. So that's a personal preference. I would recommend this for larger things and this for smaller things in terms of number of collaborators. So if you have 10 collaborators, don't do this, then save it and give your collaborators something on disk. If you know the people, then maybe that's easier. Yeah. So just to show you how this would look now in Neo, so this is exactly now the same same data file where I now use this derived IO to load the data. It's doing exactly this. It's loading this AutoML I've just shown, and it's loading the corresponding data file. Using basically a command that's similar for all the Neo IOs, which is called read block. Typically takes some parameters, which are often a bit specific than to the file. And the output is obviously a Neo block object. And what you can then do is basically print lots of stuff of the block and of the segment. So this is just a shorthand for the Neo segment that's attached to the block. And in particular, you can print, for instance, the annotations of all of these objects and so on. So if I do this, just to give you an idea, is here, for instance, you see the annotations of the Neo block, and you see that there are several pieces of key value pairs from the AutoML which are sort of describing the general experiment. So for instance, where was it recording? What was the subject name? And so on and so on. And if we look at, for instance, if we look at an analog signal, which would be a raw recording signal, then we would see here, so for instance, the connector ID or things like the channel ID, some things from pre-processing, some filter settings, and so on. So all these things which are then sometimes maybe useful to just have handy in your data. Currently, the main focus is a lot on the IOs, to be able to have IOs which read basically more or less on demand. That's one of the big things currently. So because one of the things that Neo currently suffers from, but basically I think all of the readers that you get from your vendors, is that they either read in the complete file or they're very limited in terms of what you can select, what you want to read and what not. So one of the ideas currently is to extend Neo to be able to basically read the structure of the file as a whole, but the actual data is not yet loaded. So you can selectively say, okay, but now I need this channel, but only this segment of data, so only 500 to 1,000 milliseconds, so that this is available in a generic manner and not on a goodwill basis by the file IO, whether it supports it or not. The way I see it is that Neo basically is currently mainly a test to see what types of representations and what types of objects do I need, and this there has been quite some, I would say, blowing up in the past. where people collect, we need this, this, and this, and currently it's shrinking again. So there will probably even be one more step of simplifying things in the future. But it seems that this seems to now converge to something that many people can live with. So once this is then there, I think one can also then build basically something database-y in the back end. But I guess for now, I think something like this is probably quite important, because yeah, database also has always the other problems. Yeah, so yeah. Okay, so now we are happy, so we have these neo objects, and now of course we need to do something with them. This is now again the data, spiking activity in parallel, many units, and what you probably know and what you will also realize in the next 1.5 weeks still, is that in order to understand such data, of course, it's always useful to look at many, 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 many things in order to understand it. So it's not just enough to look at just the rate, but maybe you also want to look at CVs, you want to look at mean firing rates, you want to look at rate distributions, and you want to look at many, many other things. It's just so rich data. So the question is, if you're just a simple researcher, and your time is limited, how can you try so many different things? Especially maybe you're not even the best programmer. Obviously, what we need is a way to simplify the process of trying out things on data and looking at things other people have looked at and basically sharing all these methods that people talk about in their papers and make nice figures about. So I'd like to talk about one project where I'm involved, which is the Electrophysiology Analysis Toolkit. It's basically meant as a basically an umbrella, a sort of a library to bring together analysis approaches from the community. Basically, in particular, to bring together also experiment and simulation. Probably with a focus on not just single neuron dynamics, but really on population type measures that characterize multidimensional recordings, and also with a focus on multiscale data, so things which relate, for instance, local field potentials and spikes, or these kind of measures. So the idea of Elephant is that it's based on a Neo library, so it's one of these applications sitting on top of the Neo data structure. And by this means, sort of should close this step from basically having the data loaded and now being able to easily apply analysis methods on top of them. It's basically a rather modular design, and the idea is to have it community-centered and completely open source, so there's no hidden development or any closed parts. It's really meant as a resource for the community. So at the moment, I think there's already quite a few additions to this library. I'll talk about a few of them in the past. Some from our own lab, some also from other labs who contributed to this. Some of this actually also started at this course, interestingly. So in general, Elephant has different submodules which then all tackle either a specific set of smaller analysis methods, but which sort of topically belong together. So for instance, things like spike train correlation or spike train dissimilarity, where there's lots of measures which you can use to account for these things. And also some modules which focus on a specific analysis method. So for instance, unitary events, which you will hear about in 1 or 2 days, which are methods which are a bit more complex and evolved, so they need the space of a module of their own. So here's just the slides for how to get some documentation and support. You'll find this in the PDF. So what types of functions would you want to have in such a toolbox? So on the one hand, you want to have terribly simple and stupid functions. Yeah, you just want to have them. So something like a time histogram of spikes. So this is obviously something that's super simple to do and is something that you would never want to load a toolbox for, obviously. But it has two advantages. On the one hand, you can basically do even these simple operations in a very consistent way. And the advantage of this is that you can then also modularly build up the toolbox on top of such elementary operations. So for instance, assume you have two very complex methods and you still think they should be somehow comparable. Then if you know that they do some elementary things, like for instance, binning and stuff like this on the same algorithm, then at least you can exclude a few things of where your two analysis results would differ or not differ. The other thing is basically standard analysis functions to compare analysis results across data sets. What this means is that there are certain things that we keep doing and doing, when you read the methods part of a paper, then it's typically never really explained how exactly you did it and which options you precisely set and so on. So by just giving some specific standardized analysis functions in here and specifying the parameters to set and so on, this basically gives a more formalized way of representing your analysis workflow. But of course, the most important thing is, of course, then to have methods in there which are intrinsically difficult to implement. First of all, because you're probably not the expert, because somebody spent his whole PhD developing the method. And second, because they have some know-how on how to do certain things, for instance, numerically, that you are just not aware of. I'd like to give you one example of a method which is the unitary events method. So this is something that you will hear in detail about in the talk by Sonja later. So I will not tell you exactly what's happening here, but roughly it's a method to detect synchronized spiking activity between neurons. So for instance, here between neurons 1 and 2 across many trials. And so this method, a student wanted to implement it in for the Elephant library, so there was no Python code available. As a matter of fact, there were many MATLAB and whatever codes available. It was not really clear anymore how the original publication in the 90s was exactly produced at the time and so on. I guess we all know the situation. What he did is basically he programmed the method from scratch as it was described, and I might add also completely correctly, so there was no bug in the method or anything. And he got a result on the original data, which we found after some time. And when this was compared to the original publication, then you see at first glance, now without knowing exactly what these red dots mean, they're the synchronous spikes, and without knowing exactly what this S-curve, the significance means, then at a first glance you think like, well, looks reasonably good, yeah? And actually it is reasonably good, but it's really not precise. So for instance, if you look at here, for instance, these little blips, they're quite different from here. If you would now zoom into the exact spikes, which are basically marked in here and here, it's not 100% the same. Yeah? So bottom line is, even if you follow an algorithm in a paper and re-implement it, you will get something very similar, yes, But there are so many decisions you have to make for a complex method on how to do it like this or like this, and do you first do an if statement here and then, and so on and so on. This will make differences. So in this case, what we did is we worked on this method in Elephant until we were able to completely reproduce the original finding, which you see here. It's basically now the final result, where basically the original article time points of these red dots are compared against the reproduced ones. So we were quite sure that this is now doing exactly the same thing. It was published in this journal called ReScience, which is a GitHub-based journal. I don't know who of you knows this. Yes, one. ReScience, it's a very nice journal. They publish basically replications of old science, so you can reproduce papers and publish it. And what's very nice is it's basically published on GitHub on a version control repository along with the reproduction. So essentially what's happening now is that the reproduction and the data leading to this reproduction is now basically downloaded from GitHub when the testing framework of Elephant runs through, and basically that each time somebody changes something in unitary events, basically you can check whether it still reproduces this old result. And this, I think this is one of the big advantages you can have by contributing to such toolboxes, whether it be Elephant or anything else, by really trying to have tests incorporated in your library that not just test whether your function fails if you put a string instead of a number or something like this, but also where you try to test something that reproduces something that has been done in the past, because then you can be much, much surer that what you do with the method is then really comparable to what has been done in the past. And especially for these higher order correlations, these very difficile type methods, it really depends partly. It really depends. It can make differences. Also, one thing I just want to quickly mention is that, of course, complex methods also require more cores and parallelization. And also here we try to implement methods which reduce basically the compute time. So basically one of the higher order correlation methods was optimized by a computer expert who significantly brought the time from 300 seconds to 20 seconds. So this is the time scale you gain when you have a scientist implement something versus somebody who is an expert in computer programming. But also to parallelize the thing, so it basically scales with parallel compute architectures. So how does this work? I just have a very short mock-up toy example, and again, the method itself is something you will hear about by Sonja in a few days. Now, assume we want to find some synchronous spiking patterns in data. So maybe the first thing we want to do is generate some mock data to for us just to understand what we're doing. Yeah. So what we do here is we call elephant.spiketraingeneration.compoundPoisson process. This is basically a method that generates a Poisson process with specific higher order events of a given amplitude in the data. This is implemented, and then in the second stage, we add some homogeneous Poisson process without any higher order correlations to it. And in the second part, so what comes out of this is basically a list of spike train objects. So these are basically, this STS is a list of neo spike train objects. In the second step, what we do is we call elephant.spade. Spade is basically the name of the method we're trying to use to detect these patterns. And as you can see, the main thing that we pass to this method is data equals STS, so we pass it this list of spike trains in this common neo format, plus some parameters. So when we let this run, This is basically the output. You see here the 100 neurons that we created, neurons 1, 0 to 9, or 1 to 10, whatever, basically contained these higher order patterns. And in red overlaid is what the SPADE method picked out. And you see that by this toy mock-up example, we can assure that we somehow at least roughly know what this thing is doing. Of course, in the real world, you would do something smarter than this, but just as a matter of concept. So now, assume now we want to get to the data set that we've just been talking about and repeat the analysis. I think this very nicely shows the beauty of Neo in a way. All I do here is I use the NIX.io of Neo. So for the NIX file format, I give it the file name and I say read block. I get out a Neo block, which is called real block. In the next step from this loaded file, I basically want to extract the spike trains. What I can do here is call a filter function on the real block. A filter function basically means extract from this block certain objects. And in this case, I'm telling the filter functions, get me all spike trains, which have an annotation, unit ID 1. So in other words, it's asking me, give me all spike trains, which are the first unit on each recording channel. So the best unit, in other words, from each channel. And what I get out is, again, then, by definition, a list of spike trains, STS. And this I can plug into the same spade caller as I've just shown. It's exactly the same. And then immediately I can basically get out the same analysis for real data. And this is sort of the overall idea. Now, there's Elephant. There's, of course, also other things around. And this is, I think, again, coming back to this Neo picture, the beauty if we can agree to common data formats and underlying data representations, then basically we can basically pool the types of tools we need from all over the community. I have here a list of the things I know of and I heard about at least, which may be just some starting points. There's NeuroTools. This I want to mention specifically because it's actually the father of both Neo and Elephant. So this was a project started in the early 2000s during the EU Facets project and was one of the first Python-based initiatives to actually start such tooling endeavors as a whole. Basically, this was still more or less a cluttered combination of Neo objects and analysis tools, and that's why the idea came out to basically separate the two into a separate data representation and analysis. There's also graphical tools. So for instance, Open Electrophy is something, not sure how much it's still developed by Samuel Garcia. There's also a viewer tool, which I think still works by Robert Prepper, which can basically visualize generic Neo objects and also has some basic analysis tools on board, which are also meantime integrated in Elephant. Then there are some other things, so maybe just to mention a few, PySpike, for instance, by Thomas Kreutz. He's continuously publishing his spike train metrics in this toolbox. I'm not sure if it's Neo-aware yet or not. I didn't check. And of course, there's also tools from other subfields of neuroscience, which could definitely be of interest. So for instance, there's NIPI, which is the Neuroimaging for Python initiative. They have a subproject called NIPI-TIME, which has time series type analyses, so spectral analyses and these kind of things. The M&E community has a tool for MEG and EEG type data, and so on and so on. Plus, I won't go through all of it, you'll find it in the slides. Plus, what I just want to mention is that since people keep asking me about spike sorting, Yes, spike sorting is currently exploding, as you may have seen. There's many initiatives going. There's some more classic projects such as these, but also some newer projects such as Spiking Circus, Tri de Clou, which are both neo-aware. I think, at least I think Spiking Circus is in the meantime, quite sure. Tri de Clou is for sure. Mountain Sword, for instance. So I think there's support for many different fields of applications on the rise. So in the remaining time, I'd like to spend just a few words on workflow management as a whole. So now we discussed a few tools themselves, but of course we need to embed these tools in some sort of broader workflow. And here I'd just like to mention that there is, of course, a large number of tools that are available. So personally, I'd like to think of these as several categories in a way. So of course, there's something you want to have to represent your analysis workflow pipeline as a whole. So this would be by of course, the tools themselves, maybe Elephant, but also by things like workflow engines, so things that orchestrate your workflow. And I'll say something to this particular one called SnakeMake in a second. There's also the issue of versioning and provenance. So you want to keep track of the data that you generate and about how you generate it. And also here, there's lots of tools which come into play. GitHub and versioning using Git is probably the single most important thing that every scientist should be able to do. And as you know, there will be also a party devoted to this topic later on. But also there's things like Docker environments, for instance, and other things which allow you to have basically consistent environments where you know that if you rerun your analysis a year later on your own PC, you won't get the error message, sorry, version da-da-da of the software doesn't work anymore. Yeah. Then often you will have the need to access high-performance computing. There's also tools which are typically a bit more specific to your research institution, which you need to integrate into your workflow from that side, be this queuing systems or generic systems like Unicore or other things which allow you to distribute your work on HPC machines. And finally, there's data management. I think we already heard a lot from Thomas about this GIN. There's Data Lab, is an interesting initiative, and so on. Maybe related to this, coming to SnakeMake, so I don't have time to make a complete SnakeMake tutorial, but what is SnakeMake? It's a tool that you may find interesting to check out. It's basically a way to describe your work in terms of the flow of scripts you need in order to get to a certain analysis result. And it does so in sort of a make file style. So I don't know who of you knows make. Okay, not so many. So make is a Linux tool that comes originally from programming, and make is a tool that makes a program. And what SnakeMake does is it makes your research, yeah? And it's called SnakeMake because it's Python-based, and it allows you to work particularly nicely with research projects which are in Python, because you can basically write your workflow descriptions in a pseudo-Pythonic language. That integrates nicely. What this means is that you describe your workflow in terms of so-called rules. And rules basically tell you how you get from an input file to an output file by running a certain set of commands, or in SnakeMake, you could also say by running a certain set of Python scripts. Now, the beauty of SnakeMake is that it allows you to specify your inputs and your outputs not just as pure file names, but you can specify them programmatically, which is something that often comes up in research, right? You have, for instance, this thing, I don't know, you do an analysis for every trial. So for animal A, I have 100 trials and I get 100 files out. I don't know, a JPEG with the firing rate. And in the other thing, I get, I don't know, 130 trials, yeah, of JPEGs and so on. So you have sort of a variability and you often don't know which files specifically come out. And again, I can't do a tutorial here, that would take another 2 hours, but it gives you very nice ways of basically describing your workflow. So for instance, what we have here is a rule move to manuscript. The idea is here to take the figures which you produced from your script and put them in the manuscript folder. Yeah. So the idea is you take the input from a previous rule, which is the rule to make the plots themselves, and you take the output files as the input files to this rule. The outputs will be something in the manuscript directory, yeah, and the figure directory in your manuscript file. And then what you want to run is basically just a copy command of copying the file from A to B. Yeah. So this is a very stupid example. But you can see that also for your individual research steps, you can basically build up a very nice sequence here. Now, the nice thing is, of course, that here you don't specify the workflow by saying, run this, run that, then run this. But what you say in the end is, I want to have this file. Snake, make you figure out how to build it. And if you don't know how, then just tell me, then I'll have a look. Yeah. And Snake, make will know by these rules what files exist, what files are too old, which need to be recreated, will know which rules to run in order to have a consistent output and get you exactly this file based on updated versions of all other files, timestamp based, basically. What's also very nice is, again, coming back to your question, is that this supports basically trivial parallelization on HPC architectures for a number of queuing systems and so on. So basically you can specify in the rules that you want to have this rule executed. So if you have a rule that basically needs to be executed several times, you can say, okay, execute this please using a wrapper, basically. Yeah. And also what's very nice is that if you talk about reproducibility, you can directly say for each rule which environment, so which precise Conda environment or which Docker environment you want to run this rule under in order to be sure that whatever you generated was generated with exactly these Python versions, these Neo versions, whatever. Yeah. So it's a very, it's a heavily used project, I think, in at least bioinformatics, not so much in neuroscience yet, but we're working on it. I would very much recommend this if you're looking for a solution to have a nice way of structuring your work. It's a nice read in the read the docs. Takes maybe a bit of thinking until you get used to the style of writing makefiles instead of typical thinking of do A, do B, do C. But in the end, it's much more flexible. Okay, so I'll skip this. So we still have 5 minutes. So I want to do one last step, which is now a bit stepping one step further. However, I'm sure that when you start on the projects, you will maybe be slightly reminded maybe of these slides now. So I want to talk a bit about going one step further, model validation. So you may ask, so why am I actually doing this? Yeah, why am I analyzing data? Yeah, why do I care? Yeah. So the reason you care typically is not because it's fun. Well, that's not true. Maybe because it's fun. But often you have some sort of system of interest. Yeah. You want to understand something. And just analyzing data, of course, doesn't create much understanding. Understanding comes when you try to build some sort of model out of this. Now, this can be a mathematical model, I think often it will be, but it doesn't have to be. It can be also some other model of understanding where you try to make sense of what you actually analyzed in your data. However, in neuroscience, what we often do is that we actually really try to come up with mathematical models of the neural dynamics that we observe. And I think a crucial step to understand here is that the mathematical model is, of course, something we come up with. All we can do is sort of a step of confirmation. We can think about whether this sort of matches the system. Is this a good description of the system? Is this plausible as a description, and so on? What we then typically want to do is, of course, see whether this model really reproduces something interesting in the environment. And for this, we need some sort of executable model. So this is basically a simulation, some sort of script that generates a representation based on our original mathematical model. So one thing we have to do here typically is a step called verification, which means that we try to assess that the implementation of our executable model is a correct one, computationally correct, numerically correct in particular. And then comes the interesting part. So our simulation produces something, and the question is now, does it reproduce our system of interest? Is this, so this could be reality, but it could be also a concept, like an abstract concept or whatever. And this is what we call then validation. Yeah, validation is the concept, the idea is I build a model from my understanding, and I validate it against the original system of interest. Be mindful that there's no parameter tuning here. So we're not talking about a step where I take the system of interest, then parameter tune an executable model. I don't have to validate it back. Of course, I have to cross-validate it, but in this case, of course, it's very trivial. I'm building exactly this system of interest. It's really a question of how far does this model match or not. So in this validation, I think we have many different scenarios we can account for. So there's model to experiment. That's, I think, what typically happens. There's model to model. So sometimes we may have two models and we want to see, does my new implementation actually fit to the original one? Then we can ask level validation on the network level. So for instance, does the network as a whole, the dynamics I observe in a neural network simulation as a whole, match the activity I see in the brain? Or do I try to match like a single synapse? Yeah, this is also something I could validate. So on which structural level do I validate? And then of course, I can also ask about the acceptable agreement. The acceptable agreement indicates when would I be happy with this validation process. So is it enough to just have like, looks roughly the same, or do I want something that's like spike by spike the same thing? Yeah, so that's also something to think about. So in this case, I'd just like to do one little example scenario, just because I think it could be maybe a nice way of starting to think then in your projects on the network validation testing level. And I go through it really quick. So the data I'm presenting to you now is basically from an old paper by Itsekevich. Some of you may know it. It's called polychronization. And so the reason we took this paper is because we have to be really thankful to Itsekevich, because he was actually one of the first people who actually published model code precisely on his webpage. So we are actually able to have his original simulation code from the 2006. And at this time, this was not yet standard. There was actually a big crisis at the time where people were starting to think about how can we actually convey our theoretical research. It was basically a model of three populations. And the gist of the paper at the time was these polychronous groups, so basically sequences of the network was able to learn sequences of spikes, provided with this was basically a C implementation, so a custom written C program in addition to also a MATLAB program at the time. And basically what we did is both port this to the Nest simulator, but also to the neuromorphic hardware called Spinnaker. This is basically a hardware chip performing neural network simulations. And the question was a bit, okay, now we have three different simulations, so are they doing the same thing? And how can we start assessing of whether something is the same or not, and what's now real and what's wrong and so on. Yeah. Yes, exactly. And that's the first thing to realize. Of course, you will never get spike by spike, right? Never. Yeah. For something like this. That is something we need to live with. Of course, we would hope that when we run it twice, we would get the same for something like Nest, for instance. But of course, for neuromorphic hardware, it would get very difficult. But this is basically what happened. And I think there's three things we learned. So what you see here is a comparison of the C simulation, so the original Itsekiewicz model, against the first attempt. So this was very not so convincing. Yeah. So you see this by eye. The second attempt was a bit better. The third attempt, you could almost say, well, this looks reasonably good. So if your acceptable agreement is very low, then you may actually just stop and be happy here. However, I do like to point out that looking at then measures such as, for instance, the pairwise correlations in the C versus the Spinnaker, you then see some spurious differences. You saw somehow this long tail of correlations for the Spinnaker simulation. And in correlation matrices, this showed up as these crosses here somewhere. Yeah. And then only when you look closely at the activity, then you saw that sometimes there are these blips of activity coming up, which were obviously still a bug even in this third implementation. So you may not be happy. Bottom line is that you continue to improve these simulations. And essentially what you have to do is you always have to look at many, many different measures in parallel. So for instance, here we looked at firing rates, local coefficient of variation, and a cross-correlation structure. Again, in three iterations, 1, 2, 3. And what you see is that progressively, by looking at these things, the distributions get closer and closer together. Yeah? So that in the last iteration, we would say, okay, the LV, so the regularity, is already pretty good. The cross correlations, well, and the firing rates are still too low for Spinnaker and not. Yeah? And now you could say, okay, LV is good, so that's fixed, it works, but no. Just be aware that maybe you do fixes that now the cross correlations in the next iteration, they fit perfectly. The firing rates fit perfectly, and then suddenly the LV doesn't fit anymore. Yeah. So essentially what this means is that when you're trying to compare different network states and so on, it's always a good idea to really look broadly at many different features. Just thinking that, well, the correlation structure seems to be preserved in the two things. That must mean that these lower order measures must also match. This doesn't hold, right? The regularity can differ independent of the correlation structure. That's something that is intuitively maybe not always so clear. So in the end, then you come to some final result and you think like, oh, this is really nice. Now we have like six different measures. Who cares? Maybe this is now good enough. Yeah, I see, okay, the firing rates are still a bit off, but maybe it's enough. And then I think, okay, what was this? The polychronization model. Yeah, it's all about patterns. And now we think about the middle of this lecture and we thought, okay, we have a method for patterns. Yeah. So let's find patterns in this data. So we use again this method, the spade method I talked about earlier. Now with like spatial temporal patterns, small difference, but the same thing. Yeah. And what we do, we just count the patterns and voila. Although in this last iteration all the measures look so nicely, the number of patterns we find are vastly different in the two simulations. Although the activity by eye looks basically the same. Yeah. The regularity of the patterns is the same, the frequency of them, but not the numbers. And this is probably just due to a slight difference in rate. So always be aware that when comparing different data sets, whether these are model simulations or real data, then look at many different things and think about how some measures may influence other measures. And so this is my summary. Share your code not by dumping it somewhere, but by building and contributing to community projects. It's worthwhile. Don't reinvent the wheel every time, even if it sounds fun and tempting for scientists. Yeah. Focus on the science. And think of the technical assurance, but also of the time for fun activities you will have when you know that your results are 90% part of a triple-checked and error-corrected community effort, as opposed to 100% only you. And with this, I'd just like to thank the people who contributed to most of the thing on this on these slides, but also in a broader scope, all the people contributing to these software projects and also Thomas' team. Thanks.